Hilldale, where lives connect. We're glad you're here. If you're a guest, thank you for choosing to worship with us. We're happy to see you and hope you feel right at home. To learn more about our church, what we offer, what's happening, check out yourhbc.info. Hey HBC, there will be no Saturday night service on July 4th. Again, no Saturday evening service on the 4th of July. Enjoy time with your family and we'll see you on the 5th. Beginning next week, we'll no longer have to save our seats at worship. There's more than enough room for everyone to attend safely while still following CDC guidelines. So come on in. Hilldale loves our community, and we want to make sure they know Jesus loves them too. That's why we're hosting Backyard Kids Clubs in July. Would you partner with us and host a club at your home? Supplies, crafts, even snacks will be provided. All you have to do is sign up. Help us share Jesus with kids right here in Clarksville. Hey HBC kids, it is time to get creative. We're hosting a virtual art camp July 27th through the 31st for ages 8 and up. Ages 5 and 7 are welcome to attend with parental assistance. The cost is $50 per child and includes all the supplies you'll need. Parents, the deadline to sign up is July 14th. Again, thank you for being here at Hilldale. We have so many things happening, from fitness classes to life groups and more. There's a place for everyone to connect. For more information on all these events and more, visit yourhbc.info.
Good morning. We're so glad that you joined us for worship today. Of course, it may be Sunday afternoon or even Monday or Tuesday, but we're glad that you chose to worship the Lord Jesus with us today. As we sing and think of Him, we're going to begin thinking about that day when Jesus comes again. Let's celebrate Him today.
He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break. As broken hearts declare His praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain. The sins of the world, His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. So open up the gates, make way before the King. Set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. Blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the light.
This weekend's edition of Hilldale at Home. I'm so excited about what God is doing this week in the life of our church, and I trust beyond the life of our church. We're drawing to a close, Welcome Home. Not that we're going to stop welcoming, but just that series by emphasizing grace and race. Our church's role, any church's role, in racial reconciliation. Helping to be an agent of healing in this time of such racial tension in the life of our nation. I have said on a number of occasions that I believe that the church is at the heart of the answer because we have the message of hope. We have the message of the gospel. And God has given us the ministry and the word of reconciliation. Now you may say, well, that's talking about being reconciled to God. That is true. But by extension, because we've been reconciled to God, God has broken down the barriers that divide us. And so that same word, that same ministry, I think, applies to reconciling with people. So there's a vertical reconciliation. There's also a horizontal reconciliation. And this weekend, we're emphasizing that work of horizontal reconciliation. And it's a matter of grace. The look of today's services, our service is going to be different because it's captured live from our current worship space at the Family Life Center gymnasium. And so it's going to look different, but I trust that you're going to be blessed as we welcome Pastor Clifford Wynn and his beautiful bride to us this weekend. And we're going to have first a conversation, a dialogue about grace and race. And then Pastor Clifford Wynn is going to bring this weekend's message. You are going to be blessed. I have no doubt about that. And so once again, welcome. And I trust that your heart will be challenged. I trust that your heart will be open to what God has to say. And so please, give your attention now to this conversation about grace and race, the church's role and responsibility in racial reconciliation. Privileged tonight to introduce to you some dear friends and some precious souls that you're going to learn to love very quickly. Pastor Clifford Wynn pastors Cypress Creek Church in Selmer, Tennessee. That's McNairy County. He and his wife, Janetta, are with us tonight. So give a great Hilldale welcome to Clifford and Janetta Wynn. So this weekend, we are seeking to learn. I was saying to you earlier, as I have said to our congregation, that every day that I look into the mirror, I remember that I have two ears, one mouth. I need to listen more than I talk. And in the wake of all that's been happening lately in America, I'm convinced that more than ever that those of us who have a lighter skin tone really should listen. And I want the church to be part of the solution, not part of the problem. And so this weekend we're emphasizing grace and race, the church's role in racial reconciliation. I do believe that the church is key to racial reconciliation. I would expect that we would all agree on that. What we don't talk about enough are just the practical realities of being black in America. And so I want us to just talk for a few moments, a dialogue, a conversation, if you will. Honestly, this could be the entirety of the service. I think after Clifford preaches, you'll be glad that he preached. If I were preaching, you would have said, you know what, I think I'd have rather you just had that conversation the whole time. But we're gonna have a conversation for a few moments, and so let's just jump in. If I could repeat what a lot of white people say, and just hear my heart, not trying to be rude, but a lot of white people say black people have the same opportunities as white people do. You go to the same public schools, you go to the same colleges if you want to. You can apply for the same jobs. So how are you not being treated equally in America? How would you act? Janetta, I'd love to hear your heart on that.
The say nothing, so.
Nah.
I think personally, comes down to the heart of an individual. Even though that may be on paper, I guess that we're supposed to be treated equally if we both go into a job. You have a black person, a white person go on to the job. Both are females. I believe it depends on who has the application or that who's reviewing the application. And we are, so it's the heart of who that individual, I think. Okay. Does that make sense?
It does. It does. I saw a tweet of a girl who's a PhD, and she was talking about how that she straightened her hair for her PhD doctoral defense because she knew that some people would judge her based on the color of her skin. And so she straightened her hair just to give herself one leg up. And I had never thought about somebody even having to think that way. But she did. She did.
And, you know, Pastor Larry, first I want to say, give honor to God for allowing us to be here. Hilldale, you have an awesome, awesome man of God as a pastor, and Pastor Larry Robertson. Y'all ought to give him some love. Not that you don't already do it, but we thank you all for allowing him to be used by God to invite us to come and be with you. So I just want to thank God for the traveling grace and for the greeters, those of you that have welcomed us since we came onto your premises. But I really feel the heart of the problem is the problem in the heart, and that is sin.
Yeah.
And the issue that we have, it should not be a white, black, should not be a race, but the heart of every problem within is sin. And until we don't have a change of heart, we will always deal with this same problem, dealing with racism. Because once you come in contact with Jesus, you shouldn't see color. And so that's the biggest thing that I see is that hatred, racism, those things are being taught. From a baby does not know what. Only one thing a child knows to do is cry when it's born and just want to eat. So it has to be, hatred has to be taught. So somebody is teaching from what they have been taught to a generation. So discrimination, hatred, racism, those are things that have been taught that the only way we're going to get to it, the root of it is sin. But being as a African-American man, it's hard. And I share with Pastor Larry out there is that we walk on eggshells every day. Now that all these things are taking place in our nation, the protesting, everywhere we go, we seem like we are now being brought. We normally have to sit in the stand in the line. Now they go get us. Us, Pastor Wynn, they bring us all the way up to the front. Now we go to the gas station. People, they open doors for us now. And I share that to say this, is that now whites are beginning to feel what we feel every day, and that's walking on eggshells. We walk on eggshells every day. And I share with Pastor Larry, being part of the Selma Ministerial Alliance, they allow us to become the president. These are nine churches in our county. White churches. I'm the only African-American church, which I did have a pastor, another African-American pastor that came on board. But they just to be able to be in part of that, I'm just one voice. So I have to walk on eggshells. I have to watch what I say every moment, every minute, even though they say they love Pastor
right,
Wynn.
Let me just jump in. You say you have to walk on eggshells. Why?
Because a lot of times what we say get taken out of context.
Okay.
Or I would say, too, based on what people have seen, maybe one or two, three or four or five individuals do, then they base the whole race on it. Mm-hmm. But as an individual, I've seen white people as well as black people do bad things. I see Chinese people do bad things. It has nothing to do with the color of your skin. People do bad things, but then you have white people as well as black people do good things. But I think we're often judged just by, based on what they've seen a few of us do, but that doesn't mean, you know, all of us behave like that, or all of us act like that, or all of us dress like that. It's just those, but that doesn't mean if I see one white person, all of you dress like that, or all of you behave like that.
Beth and I watched Just Mercy a week or two back, and by the way, it's free on all streaming platforms in the month of June, so if you haven't seen it, you need to see it. But I've got to be honest with you. I'm watching that movie and I'm thinking, this just cannot be real. This cannot really happen. And yet deep down I know that it does. I don't understand. From a white perspective, that honestly, that's not how we get treated. Now, I've been pulled over before when I didn't think I should have been pulled over. But they didn't pull me out of the car and throw me on the hood of the car. I mean, they didn't pull a gun on me or anything like that. So it's hard for us to imagine that reality. Because it doesn't happen to us.
By you saying that, and this the reason I wanted to applaud Hilldale Church and Pastor Larry, is that this is an opportunity for us to get to know one another.
Yes.
My people perish from a lack of knowledge. We're different. We comb our hair different. We dress different. We're different, but we still have the same blood, and that's the blood of Jesus. We hurt. We cry. We're all human. And because of that, this is opportunity for us to really just get to know. Let's get to know why we think the way we think, why we dress the way we dress, why we look. And that way, once we understand who we are and whose we are, then we'll get to, instead of this, grasping an opinion or what I think Brother Larry should wear, what he should look like. That's what I shouldn't want him to be like me. What's make unity, unity is not uniformity. Unity is diversity with maturity. In other words, I ought to be mature enough to respect him, love you for who you are, not judge you for what I want you to look like. If y'all going to amen, that was a time to amen right there.
Now, I've heard, you and I have talked about this, that, you've told me that you literally, for one of your youth Bible study nights, you brought in local police officers to teach or to coach your students and how to respond in certain situations. Tell us about that. Because I'm going to tell you, that would never happen in a white church.
I shared with my other brothers in McNary County, I shared with them, is that we like shiny stuff. Even Pastor Wynn, every vehicle I got rims on it. It's like... I like shiny stuff. I mean, but it's nothing wrong with having nice things. Just like it's nothing wrong with having money. It's when money have you. So it's nothing wrong. That's what you work for. That's what you ought to be able to reap the blessings of God. But I share with Pastor Larry was that we took a Bible class night to teach our young people that if you got pulled over by the police, make sure what we taught was, I'll let Lady Wynn talk about that.
And that's just not a Bible class. If you have a young man that is African American in your home, Pastor Larry, Sister Beth, I would advise you to teach them as well. My son, that is one of the things we had to teach him. When a police officer stops you, put your hands on 10 and 2. Ask him, may I turn on the light? My license is in the glove compartment. May I reach for them? Because for some reason, I guess from things that have happened, but like I said, it happened from a white person as well as a black person. But from things that has happened, they feel, I don't know what I want to say. I want to use the word maybe intimidated or slighted or whatever, or at a disadvantage. And so instantly, they'll draw for their gun. So if you don't teach your son, make sure you don't say nothing. Yes, sir. No, sir. Put your hands on 10 and 2 if they stop. But even the females, we have to do that as African.
Turn your light on. Turn your light on.
We have Let to him teach. Know. Ask him, may I reach for my license? They're in the glove compartment. May I reach for my license? They're in the console.
I can remember many times an older black man calling me as a teenage boy boss, and how uncomfortable that made me even then, because I'm thinking, no, I'm from the South. You're sir. I'm not your boss. But that was a mindset. I mean, would that be the right word?
Well, Pastor Larry, I want to share this with Hilldale, is that my mother taught me and trained me. We didn't say white man, white or white woman. We couldn't say that. If we couldn't say sir, yes sir, you didn't say nothing at all. I lived in Selma, Alabama when I was coming up, and the tenant was an older white guy. He came to the house, to the apartment to get his rent. And I said, Mom, some white guy at the door. I feel like she's still beating me right now. But she taught us, you always yes, sir, and no, sir. It wasn't no white man, white woman. You yes, ma'am, no, ma'am. So I say that we have always been taught and trained how to be respectful. No matter who they are, you respect them. So that's something that's always been taught and trained. So it's still like we're still having to teach and train our children how to surrender. But yet and still we're losing lives because this generation ain't talking about we shall overcome. They're not gonna talk about we come this far by faith. No, it's not that. They now have more anger because we're tired. They've been tired of being taught how to surrender, how to just be respectful, but we're not being respected.
Yeah.
And so those are things. Sometimes it seems like you get stripped as a man. You get stripped, and yet and still you work. You work day in and day out. You always have been told that you're not good enough. You can't afford to do that. I love sports. Now these children are getting abused. They're talking about their coach cussing at them. That's all I'm used to. I just say they soft. You know, my coach, that's all he done. Threw a basketball, kicked you, done whatever. We took those things. This generation not taking that.
But I think that's where the believers come in too. And that's where we can help bring that hurt and keep that hurt from going to anger by introducing them to Jesus.
You said something a moment ago, I confess I don't completely agree with you. You said that, you know, once we come to Christ, we shouldn't see race. I don't agree with that because I think God made the races. And that is something to be embraced and celebrated. And in fact, when we read Revelation, and we'll wrap up with this and pray, but when we read in the Revelation, the scene of heaven, we see John describing the people around the throne. And how did he describe them? But people from every tribe and tongue, peoples and nations on earth. And so he was seeing different skin tones, different ethnicities, hearing different languages. He was seeing all these differences, but they were united in one common practice, and that was worship. And so I don't think that anybody has to apologize for their race or say, you know, hey, I don't, you're black. I didn't know you were black. I didn't even see that. Well, obviously I see that you're black, but that doesn't have to be a matter of division. It can be a matter of celebration that God made you the way that he made you. He made me the way that he made me. But you're no better, you're no worse, I'm no better, I'm no worse. At the end of the day, we're just sinners.
Shall we say that we see race, but God sees the heart?
Oh, yeah.
Or just no different treatment based on the race.
This is why you're here. This is why you're here. So
you're going to leave a brother hanging.
But I do believe that what's happening right now is an opportunity for revival in the church, because we have the opportunity right now to embrace this picture of what we're going to be for eternity. Every tribe, tongue, people, and nation coming together to worship. And toward that end, I pray that we'll work and pray. So let's pray now. Gracious Father, thank you for the opportunity to have this conversation. But Lord, I pray that this would not be the end. I pray this would not bring the dialogue to a close. I pray, Lord, if anything, it just gets the conversation going, that we as a congregation will give more thought and engage in more conversation in these matters. I pray that we who are white would be more intentional to listen to our black neighbors and our black brothers and sisters in Christ, and listen more than we talk. Lord, none of this is easy. None of this is simple. And there will never be a quick fix. But Lord, we know this, that your desire is for us to demonstrate our relationship with you, that we are your disciples, if we have love one for another. And so, Father, I pray that will be our defining characteristic as the people of God. Not that we're a white church or a black church or any kind of adjective based on skin color, but that we're a church that loves God and loves people, period. Father, I thank you for Clifford. I thank you for Janetta. Lord, I thank you for their willingness to be transparent here tonight. And Lord, I thank you for the Hilldale family.
Yes, Lord,
I thank you so much for their willingness to be receptive to what you are saying from this platform tonight. Lord, may we be like Samuel and just stand before you and say, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." Lord, all that you have for us to hear, all that you have for us to learn, Lord, may we be willing and ready to hear. And we pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Once again, say thank you to Clifford and Janetta Wynn. You've already heard the heart of Clifford Wynn, and you've heard him to be passionate. And it's one of the things that I love about him. He's the real deal. And it is my privilege to invite Pastor Clifford to our pulpit, and for you to hear him open the Word of God and bring God's Word to us this evening. And so, Pastor, if you will, come. I want to have a word of prayer with you. And then you take us to the throne in the Word. Gracious Father, thank you for my brother. Thank you, Lord, for his heart for you, his faithfulness through the years, for the long haul, the long term, being faithful in ministry. And Father, I pray that tonight you will speak clearly through your servant, through your preacher. And Lord, may he open the Word, and may the Word speak to our hearts with clarity and with conviction. Yes. May your Holy Spirit massage your Word into our hearts. And we are here to listen and to receive and to obey. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Can we put our hands together for God? Amen. Thank you for mine. I said for God. Yeah, y'all catch it. Oh. Amen. I want to again thank God for this opportunity to come to be with you. Amen. I don't know no other way to be when it comes to God is to be excited. Amen. I love God. And I not only do I love God, but I love God's people. So when I was in the world, I always loved to have fun. I loved to laugh. So when I got saved, when God delivered me from the world, out of the world, amen, I felt like we should still have that same energy, that same excitement for God as we did when we was running for the devil. So again, can I ask you, can we put our hands together for God? Yeah, there you go. Amen. We thank God for God. We thank God for Jesus the Christ, he that knew no sin but became sin for us. and to the gift that's been given to every blood believer, the gift of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And we thank God for this beautiful lady that God has blessed to have, Lady Janetta, who traveled with us to come to be with the Hilldale family. Amen. Wherever, there she is right there. Thank God for my wife. Amen. We were not able to bring our children with us, Noah and Owen. Amen. Pastor Larry, I want to encourage you. Amen. You're doing a fine job. You keep feeding them. Eventually, they're going to look like you. Amen. That's what I have two little ones. I always say they Wynnites, but they're two little white guys that came that God blessed us to have. And I tell them all the time, boy, y'all look more like me more than my own biological children. But Noah and Owen, we have been blessed to have them in our life. They've been with us for 2 years. Amen. And it's just a blessing. So I want to thank you, Pastor Larry Robinson and Lady Robinson. Y'all are doing an awesome job. I mean, keep doing what you're doing. Let's thank God for the Robinson family. Amen. We do not honor our wives enough. Amen. But we do want to let them know we appreciate this opportunity to be with the Hilldale. And I have to ask you to give God praise. I ask you to thank God for wife and for pastors. Give yourself, maybe I get everybody, give yourself some praise. What about that? Amen. Aren't you glad to be alive? Amen. I asked Pastor how long he'd normally be here. He said he normally gets y'all out by 6:45. That's what I thought. Amen. But I promise you, amen, we're going to just give a brief word that God has put in our heart from the Gospel of St. Luke, St. Luke chapter 2. Amen. I want to emphasize on the childhood of Jesus in the Gospel of St. Luke chapter 2. Didn't really know what to expect. My wife, I was sharing with her, I said, at home at Cyprus, we have the tendency to cut up. They always say he cut up, he cut a rug. Amen. So the same God that's in Selma is the same God here at Clark's. Was that right? Amen. So we just going to let God be God, and we're going to attempt to do, amen, to bring no hurt, no harm, but to help this ministry. And I thank you, Pastor Larry, for trusting us to come and help the minister of Hilldale. The Gospel of St. Luke chapter 2, verse 40 says, "And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover." Verse 42 said, "And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast. And when they had fulfilled the days that they returned, the child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem. And Joseph and his mother knew not of it. But they, supposing him to have been in the company, went a day's journey. And they sought him among their kinfolk and acquaintance. And when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him. And it came to pass, after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of doctors, both hearing them and asking them questions. And all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers." Verse 48 said, "And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, Son, why hast thou dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. And he said unto them, How is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my father's business? And they understood not the saying which he spake unto them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject unto them. But his mother kept all these sayings in her heart." Last but not least, "And Jesus increased in wisdom, stature, in favor with God and man." Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. May the people of God say together, amen. Amen. Considering all that's been going on and what we're dealing with on this weekend, amen, and I wanted to just say something to encourage us. I heard Pastor talk about grace and race. Amen. That it's by the grace of God that we all have made it. Amen. But as a Christian, we need to understand our Christian faith began, and shall we say it begun, when we start putting our faith in God through what Jesus done on Calvary Cross. Amen. That's the beginning of our Christian journey, is putting our faith in God. Many times, my brothers and sisters, that we fail to develop in our faith. Amen. That it's many grow old but never grow up, simply because they fail to develop in their faith. Let me slow my roll. Let me say that again. Many fail to develop. I gave the preacher my hand and I gave God my heart. I am saved. I'm good. Amen. But it's not about our profession as it is about our progression. Let me say again, because it's not that I'm talking too fast. Maybe we're listening too slow. I say it's not so much about our profession as it is about our progression. In other words, it's important that we continue to grow. We continue to mature in our faith. We are saved not by loving God. We are saved by believing in God. Is that good? I say, we're not saved by loving God. We are saved by believing in God. So that is the beginning of our journey as a Christian, is that we now believe in God. So, Pastor, where do I go? Boy, y'all asking some good questions right there. Where do I go? How do I develop? Amen. When we fail to develop in our faith, it causes the body to become deformed. Are y'all good on that? When we fail to develop, when we fail to mature in our faith, it causes the body of Christ to become deformed. And once the body becomes deformed, that's why we have divisions in our homes. That's why we have the, is that okay for me to walk? Okay. I teach with my hand. Okay, can I walk? Are y'all good with me? Okay, so just stay with me, okay? When we fail to develop, it causes the body to become deformed. In other words, we become, amen, this out of place. We out of order, amen. You have the head, amen, somewhere on the shoulder. You got the eye supposed to be where it's located. It's now on the chin, and you got the nose where the ear. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You got the foot want to be the arm, because now we are deformed because we fail to what? Develop. And when we fail to develop and mature in our faith, that's where we have division. That's where we have division, and that's why I say, amen, let me help us here, Hilldale, because I say this to the church. God don't care about your membership. He don't care how many people you have on your roll and how many people show up and how many people are watching on Facebook or live stream. It's not about membership. It's about discipleship. Let me say again, because I say it's not about membership. It's about discipleship. When you become a disciple, that I'm teaching more than y'all, amen. When you become a disciple, that means you're living to be like Jesus. Do I have somebody? But when you become a member, you join Macy's. You become part of JCPenney's. You become part of the motorcycle club, the Sam's Club. You know what I'm talking about. You will become a member. But God said, I didn't call you to be a member. He said, I want you to become, follow me, and I'll make you become fishermen of men. You become a disciple. Well, what is a disciple? Think, boy, y'all asking me some good questions. A disciple is someone that's living Christ-like. You are a disciple when they watch this. The problem is that many problems in our churches, the reason there's division is because we're not developing to become disciple. What church? I'm a member of Hilldale. I'm on the Deacon Bowl. I've been at Hilldale. I've been at Cypress Creek. That's my grandpa. My grandmama built that church. I wish I had some help right here. In other words, amen, you signed up to become a member, but you have failed to become a disciple. Watch this. So why are you saying all this, Pastor Wynn? Boy, y'all asking me some good questions. The question is that I want to help us to understand if we're not going to stop racism, we're not going to stop discrimination. Okay? All the protesting is not going to stop any. Listen, the protesting is just saying that, hey, man, we want to start to do something. The protesting is not the solution to the problem. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? So the solution to the problems is that it's the problem that's in our hearts. The problem in our hearts, watch this, is what's in our hearts is what we call sin. Sin is a self-interest nature. It's what I like, what I think, what I want, what I think it should be, how he ought to look, what he ought to do. That's a self-interest nature. And can I tell you, we all kin folks. I said, we all kin folks. I said, we all kin folks. I don't know you. You don't know me, but we all kin. Why you say we kin? Because we have one thing in common, and that's sin. There ain't no such thing of a white sin. Ain't no such thing of a black sin. We all sinners, but we've been saved by grace. Am I teaching? So I want to help us to understand the importance tonight of developing in our faith is part of the solution of our problems. Watch this. If you want a better husband, become a better wife. I just try to make sense. But y'all ain't gonna say nothing. Y'all ain't gonna holler at the brother, are you? If you want a better wife, you become a better husband. Huh? So the problem, we can always pick and point our little bony fingers at what everybody else doing. I spoke to her, she didn't speak to me. There's something wrong with it. Now, it may not be them. It may be what's in. The problem is not in the land. The problem is in the man. Boy, y'all a tough crowd on Saturday. Y'all must got a club some down the road we got to go to. Y'all got a party? Anybody got barbecue? Somebody barbecuing or something? Is that what's wrong? I'm not going to be long. But I want us to understand something is that sin is the root of all of our problems. Sin is the root. And that's what Jesus came. He came, amen, to help us, amen, because after the fall of man, we were all doomed. We was all destined. We was all getting ready to be destroyed. We was all headed to death because the wages of sin is. Is anybody here perfect? Anybody here don't deal with sin? This is your opportunity to throw your Baptist finger up and tip out of here. Anybody here? And what I'm telling you, may not did. If you didn't do it, but you thought it, guess what you done? You sin. Are y'all good? So the Bible said, for we all have sinned and come short. In other words, I don't care how tall, I'm 6'2", guess what, I'm still short. We all short folks. We got to stop comparing ourselves to each other and compare ourselves to Jesus. And when we compare ourselves to Jesus, we will realize I'm still falling short. I still got some growing up to do. I still got some things that God needs to work out. Because I'm saved, sanctified, filled, sealed with the Holy Ghost, I still deal with sin. So watch this. Jesus. See, we always, the only thing you hear about here, Pastor, I'm getting ready to close. I'm going to hurt you tonight. Because they're going to be like, I want that preacher to come back. We ain't never got out of here at 7 o'clock. Chicken still hot. Favorite TV show is on. Pastor, won't you call Pastor Wynn back? But let me tell you something. It ain't that I preach too long. It's the summertime and the religion is too short. Woo. See, this is what I tell you. Now we want to put the preacher on the time. Watch. But watch this. I need you to hear this. Once we understand, let me get to this. Once we understand the sin nature of us, we all deal with sin. We all fall short. Jesus here, the only time we hear about Jesus is Jesus in the cradle. Jesus now healing people. Jesus now being betrayed. Jesus now have gone to the cross. Jesus now been in the grave. Jesus now been risen. He's resurrected. Now Jesus is ascended into heaven. And now he's sitting at the right hand of the Father. That's good news, isn't it? But can I tell you something? Jesus had two natures. He had a divinity side and a humanity side. He was just like you and I. He had to develop as a human in order to understand the infirmities that we deal with, the temptations, the trial. Listen, God didn't, watch this. God didn't call you to be a superhero. He didn't call you to be Superman, Wonder Woman, He-Man, Batman, Spider-Man, Popeye the Sailor Man. He didn't call you to become a superhero. That's why he sent Jesus. There's only one hero, and that man was Jesus. He was the only one that walked on this earth and seen it not. So guess what? Because there's only one hero, that means God wants you to understand you are only human. That means you are emotional. We all gonna cry. Anybody cry beside me? See, y'all saved, folks. Keep on living. Your children. See, so come on. We are emotional. I'm trying to help us make sure we all human. We all cry. I don't care how big you are. I don't care how muscular you are. I don't care how big and thick your beard are. You're human. You're going to what? Cry. Not only are we going to cry, but every human needs somebody to talk to. Keep standing in the man cave, and I don't need them, I'm good. That's why you walk around mad and miserable, because you're afraid to open up and talk to somebody. Everybody needs somebody to talk to. Why? Because we are all human. Watch this. Not only are we all emotional, and not only are we all communal, but we all mortal. What do you mean, Pastor Wynn? That means we all are going to die. A man that's born of a woman is only for a few days, and you're going to deal with what? Trouble. The writer of Hebrews 9:27 say, it's appointed for man to die once. After death, there comes judgment. So guess what? We're all not superheroes. We're all what? We're all going to die. Are y'all good? Not only are we immortal, but we all have mores. In other words, we're intelligent. We know right from wrong. There's two spirits in all of us. There's a good spirit. Stop beating yourself up, brother. Stop beating yourself up, sister. Guess what? There's a spiritual warfare that goes on in all of us. Every time I want to do good, there's another spirit that pulls me to make me want to do what I don't want to do. The thing that I want to do, I can't do. The thing that I do, I don't want to do. Paul says, oh, wretched man that I am. It ain't me, it's the sin that's. Can you not see Jesus now? The reason why he had to develop. And not only did we have to realize we're Moors, we're intelligent, we know right from wrong, but we struggle doing what's right because of the enemy that pulls us. But we need to understand something. God died that we may live. It's 7:03. Give me 2 minutes and we out of here. Watch this. Jesus not only, watch this, he developed physically in his body. It's right here in your Bible if you hadn't tore it out. I hope y'all didn't tear it out, did you? Verse 40 says, the child done what? He grew. In other words, he grew physically. That's why it's important to push the pork chops away, the chitlins, the pig feet, the hogs. I wish I had somebody in here. You have to understand, our bodies are the temple of the Holy Ghost. God no longer dwells in houses that's made of man's hand. He now dwells in our bodies. Our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Jesus grew physically. That's why Paul said over in 1 Timothy 4:7, he said 4:8, is that body exercise profit little. In other words, we got to start taking care of our bodies. Hello? Now I'm cussing because I said exercise. Instead of running and trying to just take a pill for everything, get some unk about yourself. What's wrong getting up exercising? Jesus grew physically. Not only did he grow, are y'all good? Watch this. Not only did he grow physically, but he grew in wisdom. The Bible says wisdom is the principal thing. In all thy getting, get an understanding. Now watch this. Let me borrow 2 more minutes. Because some of you think because you got gray hair, now you wise. Because you got gray hair don't make you have wisdom. That means you stressed. you know, because you grow old and you got gray hair, I'm a wise man. I know a whole lot of 13-year-old got a lot of. So having gray hair does not mean you wise. I know a whole lot of old folks, and I'm talking to some senior saints, that grew old but never grew up. But Jesus, listen to what James, if any man lacketh wisdom, let him ask of God, who give it to all men liberally. Wisdom does not come from life experiences. Wisdom comes from God. Now, he done cracked your head all your life, and you tell me, I'm wise now. No, you just done woke up. I know it'd be my last time here, but after that one. We need to know that. Stop saying these things when you're thinking, amen. The devil makes us feel like we have grown and we're not developing. But Jesus, he grew physically and he grew intelligently with wisdom. Let's learn to develop in our faith. When we fail to develop in our faith, it causes our body to become deformed. And when our body becomes deformed, it causes division. God is not the author of no confusion. God bless you. May God forever keep you.
Wow. I'm so grateful for this conversation and then this message that we've heard today. I want to tailor the invitation, though, to our viewers at home, because obviously we've extended an invitation to those who were under the same roof and, you know, publicly gathering. But I also want you to know at home that you can respond to today's message by either of two ways. One is you can go to our info hub, yourhbc.info, and you will very easily find the I Have Decided tab. And you simply click on that. Let us know who you are, an email address. There's a box there, though, where you can say, I want to become a Christian, or I want to rededicate my life to the Lord, or I want to be baptized. I want to join Hilldale Baptist Church. I want someone to pray for me. You just tell us what it is that you would tell a pastor if you came forward during a public service. And we will send that to the appropriate person who will be in touch with you very soon. It may be easier for you to simply send us a text message. We have a dedicated telephone number, 931-236-3085. for. It's there on the screen, 931-236-3084. If you want to follow Christ, you want to give your heart to Jesus, simply send us a single word, the word believe. And if we receive that word, we're going to understand what it is that you're saying, and we'll be in touch with you to help you take those steps toward Jesus. Maybe you want to be baptized. You're already a believer, but you've never confessed Jesus in the waters of baptism. Then simply send the word baptize to that number, 931-236-3084. Or you want to rededicate your life to the Lord, then simply send the word rededicate. Or you need someone to pray with you, to pray for you, simply send the word pray. And with each of those, we have someone waiting to receive your text message, and we'll be back in touch with you very shortly. And so with this next song, let's just call this our invitation song, and with this song, we will close. Simply reach out to us, and we'll be in touch with you soon, because we want to help you take your next steps with Jesus. So God bless you. Do that now, and we'll be in touch.
Been there 10,000 years, bright shine.